Holics Network 18, Mission Poshan, Bhavishya Roshan.
You're with us here on a fresh new edition of Midcap Radar. I'm Prashant Nair. With me is my colleague Sumaira Abdi. 65 points on the Nifty, so holding the gains. 0.6% is what that translates into. The Midcap Index is up about 131 odd points as well. So 0.75% gain. And I mean, you know, the story over the last at least 20 minutes has been sugar and what's been happening with the sugar stocks. They were higher by about 1 to 2% before the announcement came from the cabinet. They rallied a little bit more after the announcement came, hit the wires, and they've sold off. I would say extremely predictable kind of reaction to these sugar stocks and the news which came through. The chorus of opinion is, well, it's good the government is doing something, but is anywhere but enough in terms of what we need. And that's been a line that we've heard from sugar companies for years now. So every once in a while, a package comes and it kind of falls short. And it's perennially, in a way, a troubled kind of space. But we'll get you more on sugar and, of course, the rest of the market as well. It's awaiting, in the next 1 hour, the RBI policy decision. Sumaira Afnan.
Hi, Prashant. Good afternoon to you. So first up, let's take stock of all of our top stories. The market is at the day's high. Heavyweights Reliance, Infosys and L&T lead. Midcap Index outperforms, shrugging off the nervousness of the last few days.
90% respondents to the CNBC TV18 poll expect a status quo by the Reserve Bank of India in terms of action. The principal economic advisor to the Government of India, Sanjeev Sanyal, says rising yields will impact growth. Morgan Stanley's Chetan Iyer expects a hawkish tone as far as the policy goes.
Cabinet approves an 8,000 crore rupee relief package for the sugar sector. Minimum support price for sugar set at 29 rupees a kilo. Management of Balrampur Chini calls the MSP unrealistic.
The Kharif crop sowing season starts, but there is still no clarity on the new minimum support price regime. The Agri Ministry is yet to finalise the cost of the scheme after Finance Ministry has asked for revisions, since it won't be able to bear the annual expenditure of almost 20,000 crore rupees.
And RBI gives a go-ahead for the IDFC Bank Capital First merger, moved to be complete in 4 to 5 months. Rajiv Lal to chair the new entity. V. Vaidyanathan will be the CEO.
Okay, so that's essentially the top headline so far. Ashwani is with us. Ashwani, good afternoon. Thanks very much. I mean, before we get to the market, if you want to offer a quick comment on what we've seen in this sugar pop and sell-off already.
See, the main problem with sugar is that there is a large voting population that is involved. Otherwise, in all commodities, when prices are up, these guys enjoy. Balrampur Chini even thought of opening an NBFC when times were good. And when times are bad, you know, everybody suffers. But here, because we, you know, manipulate prices, you know, in bad times, things get a lot worse. The downtrend in sugar continues. This is a pop. It should be sold into, and sugar stocks will see further lows. They will not turn around till the trend of sugar prices turns around.
Okay, fair enough. Your thoughts on the index, Nifty, Bank Nifty, Midcaps?
See, for the day, the short covering should continue. My sense is that there's a lot of fear priced into the market, and unless, you know, it's totally out of whack, I think even a 25 basis point hike would lead to further short covering. So my sense is that financials, NBFCs, etc. Should do well even after the policy. And mid-caps anyway, the pullback continues. So that way, Srei Infra is a buy with a stop of 70, target of 84. Capital First is a buy with a stop of 555, target of 580. And Titan is a buy with a stop of 880, target of 915.
The action is fine. I mean, you're saying that even 25 basis points, short covering could continue. But, as I think Latha was pointing out sometime back, that the commentary, if RBI, for example, says that we're at the cusp of a rate increasing cycle, I mean, what would that do to sentiment and stocks, Ashwani, according to you?
See, if we were at 27,000 Bank Nifty, that would be bad news. See, the market is very intelligent. It tends to price in, given the information, and they are pricing in some kind of hawkish commentary, etc. So maybe, longer term, you would still make new lows. But I think today it will lead to a short covering rally, because basically the worst possible outcome seems to be in the price. That is the reason we fell from 27,000 to about 26,200 thereabouts. So today's short covering will be there. Maybe tomorrow, day after, the market will realize that rates are still going up. But today is a good time for the market to do some sort of short covering, prepare for the next decline.
All right, Ashwani, thanks very much for your thoughts and for your trading ideas as well. Let's get in some other market voices. HSBC's Bill Maldonado says India does not look attractive based on valuations, though Neelkant Mishra of Credit Suisse says that he expects Sensex earnings to grow 25% in FY19.
As investors, we're less worried about the politics and we're much more interested in the reform agenda in India. We've seen, I would say, three very important pieces of reform that are game changers for the Indian economy. We've seen GST being brought in and being implemented successfully by this government. We've seen the credit resolution environment being set up and being implemented. We're now seeing the first insolvencies, the first big insolvencies going through that process towards a very successful resolution. And finally, we've seen a recapitalization or an announcement around the recapitalization of the public sector banks.
We have seen a 3.6% correction, rather cut to FY19 EPS after the results season, the March quarter results. The year-on-year growth now is 34% in FY19, which looks very high, but that's because there are a lot of one-offs in the FY18 base. But I still think that we will end up at 25-26%. So by and large, some cuts will continue, but hopefully not at the pace at which we saw them in the March quarter. The FY18 numbers are 6-7% lower than they should be. Then at a 25% growth that we now think FY19 will settle at, we're actually talking about a 17-18% growth, which is not that aggressive. We could be 2-3 percentage points more aggressive, but because of the low base of FY18, the headline for FY19 will look strong.
Okay, that's Neelkant Mishra at Credit Suisse with his thoughts on earnings. We slip into a very quick break. We get chatting with the management at Kaplan Point Laboratories. The stock saw a very large fall recently. It's bouncing a bit. Vivek Siddharth, the COO of the company, joins in. Stay tuned.
But let's take you straight and hear out the CEO of Infosys, Salil Parekh, who's outlining the growth roadmap for the company.
More into fiscal 19. So for us, it's easy now to start to talk year-on-year comparison, that we can manage what we think is growing fast, where we need investment, where we see skills shortage, or where there's more demand. So in terms of the industry itself, I think you probably have to ask some of the other companies of how that is done, and maybe it might involve a little bit of work with you to take this framework and then map it to some others. We think this is comprehensive, but hopefully you see that as well as we start to announce the numbers each quarter. On the morale, I think with all of the changes we've had, I've spent a lot of time with our employees. The good news for me is our employees are very keen that they be part of a company that's the number one company in the industry. There's a huge amount of pride in being there. Of course, with all of the changes that have happened, my sense is with the transformation that we are driving, we need a phase of calming things down and stabilizing. And that's why fiscal 19 is how we've defined as a stabilizing year to drive that. My sense is if we can demonstrate that through this year, we will see a far better, stronger organization that drives all of the changes in the transformation. In the pyramid, I think that's an ongoing situation in large businesses. I don't particularly see that our pyramid has a huge inefficiency, but I think we have to constantly improve it as we go through this phase and the next phase. So I don't think that's static, where something has got stuck somewhere. It's an ongoing sort of activity within a business like ours.
All right, we'll sort of keep listening into the Infosys presentation, and we'll get cut back in when there is important stuff which is being spoken about. But that's Salil Parekh, CEO at Infosys, making that presentation. Okay, Caplin Point is the stock that we're going to focus on. It's going to come up on your screen. It's, I think, up 10%. That's the daily limit. And this has come about after a near 44% drop in its value over the last 7 days. I mean, that's 7 days earlier to today's lowest point, 44% lower over the last 7 days. And of course, from the all-time high, it's done even more poorly, some 55, 57% off the all-time high. Vivek Siddharth, this Chief Operating Officer of the company, is joining us on the phone line. Vivek, thank you very much for your time. During this precipitous drop that we saw of almost 44, 45% before this rebound, did investors reach out to you in terms of what was happening? Were there any specific concerns? There was one issue about receivables, which we will just talk about in a bit. But first, just if you could let us know if there were any investors who reached out in this during the course of the last 7 days.
Yeah, so we think it's been a bit of an unnecessary reaction or a knee-jerk reaction from some sections. But the good news is that several of our long-term investors have called us, and they've had good things to say, and they actually couldn't believe why, despite the company delivering a very good year-on-year performance, why the reaction has been like that. I mean, the fundamentals of the company has not changed overnight. If anything, we're in a better position this year than we were in last year. And there's been a conscious decision from our side to enter into newer segments such as branded generics and newer markets where there's been some credit-oriented business. But this is well within our industry average. This is well within our own, conscious decisions. Sure. And we don't foresee why we should be worried about that at all. It's not a credit risk per se. It's a credit business, not a credit risk.
Okay, Vivek. You know, usually I don't ask questions about a stock to the management, but you know, a near 50% drop in the market capitalization. I'm sure you would have, you and the management would have sort of taken notice, absolutely. So could you give us some sense? I mean, you don't see a 50% erosion, near 50% erosion without some large investor exiting or some such thing. Maybe promoter selling, just some sense of what really went down.
I'll answer your last point. Since 1994 till 2018, there's not been a single stock that has been sold from the promoter's stake. Mm. We'll be putting out a press release quite soon on that. There's been absolutely no purchase or sell-off of any percentage of the promoter's stake in over 20-odd years. And in terms of stock, look, the only thing we can do is make sure that we try and continue running the company well, keeping our fundamentals intact, keeping our balance sheet as strong and our cash flow as strong as possible. The rest is down to the market. Hopefully, it appreciates. And we did have a good run. And to be honest with you, these things are out of our hands. The only thing we can continue to do is to maintain our integrity, maintain our ethics well, and to run the company well, you know.
Okay. So Vivek, just one more question then on the receivables. I was reading the note that you have put out to investors on the exchanges. And the big concern, of course, was the negative working cap cycles. But, you know, nowhere can I find clarity on how long you expect this issue to be there. I mean, I understand your expansion plans and this whole business of, generics requiring a longer line of credit or perhaps extending it to newer people. But do you think through FY19 this issue will persist?
See, the receivables is going to be a part of the business for at least the next 36 to 48 months. That's what we see. But see, the thing is, whatever the negative working capital cycle that we had built up a couple of years ago, this wasn't built up overnight. This was a constant work in progress over a period of time. But the thing is, the market started to take notice of our stock only sometime after 2012 and 2013, and that's when it was a bit of a euphoria for them to find a company that had a negative working capital cycle. We are fully committed to coming back to a similar sort of scenario in the next 3 to 4 years. But in many in more ways than one, I think we've been a victim of our own past successes in some terms, you know.
But I mean, for at least the next 3-4 years, you would run. It's going to be post that sometime, right? You get back to the negative working capital situation.
The thing is, this is not something that has gone out of our control or anything like that. Once again, I repeat,
it's a conscious decision.
And it's well within the industry average, if I'm not wrong, which is about 80 to 100 days. So we're at 87 days. And this is something that was likely to remain. But if you looked at the company's rest of the balance sheet, we've managed to increase our cash and cash surpluses from 100 plus crore to 125 crores. We've put in another 52 crore in capex last year.
Got it.
So all things considered, you can understand that whatever the receivables on our books is not really affecting the business in any shape or form.
Just one quick question. I don't know if you give out a guidance or you'd like to, for FY19, what would revenues look like? I mean, you crossed 500 crores in 18.
Yeah, we've maintained the same statement from earlier that we are looking at growing about 20 to 25% year on year. But the largest statement that we've made out a couple of years ago is our intention is to turn the top line from 2015 into the bottom line of 2021. You know? So we're committed to making that happen.
All right, Vivek, thanks very much for joining in. Appreciate your presence. So the management there clarifying on a whole host of investor concerns. But we need to take a quick break. More on the market when we're back.